Yeah, I'm Stephen. I'm an entomologist. I'm interested in insects. I've managed to make a career out of it. I've been studying them since I was about 12. I started quite early, and I just live and breathe it. But luckily, there's a big focus on pollinators at the moment, and pollinators have always been my first love. So I work part time for Blooms for Bees, and the rest of the time I'm a freelance entomologist, ecologist, a bit like a bumblebee or a butterfly, flitting from flower to flower. Only my flowers are my clients. So you're one of my sort of clients, really, but one of my favourite clients. Okay, so who am I? I'm not going to go through all of that. This is a talk. It's worth saying this is a talk I give all over the country to people that manage land for pollinators. I give it to wildlife trusts, ranger services, Environment Agency, National Trust, and so I've adapted it slightly for you. It's something I would normally do in more than 40 minutes, so I'm not expecting to take it all in. Just enjoy it, really. But I've done quite a lot in my life. I've written a few books. I've put a lot of stuff online. I've worked for various organisations. But basically, this is me. I'm still that overgrown kid. I still get excited like a young child when I see something rare. And that's what keeps me going. It's that sort of childhood enthusiasm, which is the best way to do natural history, to be honest. Okay. What is a pollinator? So a pollinator is an organism, usually a flying insect, but not always, because when you go abroad, there's all sorts of pollinators. So in fact, if you go to Bristol Botanical Gardens, which is a fantastic place, part of their display is about the different groups of organisms that transfer pollen from one plant to another and bring about pollination. So it also includes things like fruit bats, birds, what other things, possums. On a world basis, there's all sorts of things that can bring about pollination, but in Britain it's mostly insects. So you get the pollination that allows seed formation and fruit formation. Even a lot of the vegetables we eat require pollinators to propagate them, you know, the potatoes and things like that. So bees and hoverflies, they're the best known pollinators, and people think they're the only pollinators. In fact, some people think honeybee is the only pollinator. Hello. But actually they only represent a tiny proportion of the pollinators. So it's funny, if you go into the DEFRA English pollinator strategy, it says, gosh, there are 1,500 pollinators in Britain. I've actually got the list up at 6,000 now, 6,000 pollinators. So these are things that visit flowers regularly enough to transfer pollen. Some of them are great pollinators, they carry loads of pollen on their bodies, the bees and the hoverflies. Others are minor players, but still do a little bit. And that includes beetles and bugs, which aren't, they're not brilliant pollinators, but they're still pollinators. Why are pollinators so important? Well, depending on your diet, my diet isn't particularly brilliant, but it's been averaged out that a third of what humanity eats requires a pollinator. And that includes, obviously your apples, chocolate, peanut butter, tomato and potato. A lot of what we eat requires a pollinator. In terms of highly economic terms, they're worth nearly £700 million just in the UK, a lot more globally. They bring about what we call, you probably know this term, ecosystem services. And people say, oh, Stephen, what does ecosystem services mean? It means, what does nature do for us? When it puts food on our tables, it cleans our water, it cleans the air, it creates oxygen, sucks in carbon dioxide. That's all ecosystem services. Pollinators are an important element of ecosystem services. But we also know many British wild pollinators are declining. We know that many ecosystems require pollinators, otherwise they collapse. And we also know there aren't enough honeybees to do all the crop pollination that we require. And here are some examples of things that require pollinators, including conkers, because you can't have a conker fight without pollinators, and that's really critical. Critically important. Okay. Some pollinator facts. That's some insect facts. We've got over 24,000 species of insects in Britain, and we're still discovering new ones. I'm still discovering new bees in Britain, which is all very exciting. I think it's about a million described insects on Earth, and we think that's probably 5% of the total number, because there are just, you have to do lots of DNA analysis to work out how many species are knocking about. But what we know is that of 24,000 British insects, as I say, at least 6,000 visit flowers regularly. That includes 2,000 sorts of wasp. I'm not talking about the black and white striped wasp. For the most part, those small parasitic wasps. They're mostly flower visitors. 260 sorts of bee, 1,500 sorts of fly, at least 1,500 sorts of butterfly and moth, 250 beetles, and that pie diagram kind of encapsulates what's going on there. And yeah, a lot of that is wasps, believe it or not. Wasps like this, Newman wasps, which are parasites mainly of caterpillars. But they're not very good pollinators because they're not very furry, but they do carry a bit of pollen. Bees and hoverflies tend to be the most effective. They tend to get a lot of pollen in their body, and they're very active. They move around the landscape between flowers, so they're very efficient pollinators. But it's worth saying, if you take something like common figwort, which is a fairly frequent plant in Warwickshire, the main pollinator of common figwort is social wasps. You know, the sorts of wasps that make a nuisance to themselves when you're having a picnic. That's their main pollinator. And this is a critical thing. The UK honeybee stock has been estimated only to pollinate one third of our crops. The rest is done by wild pollinators for free. So if you go to a field of oil seed rape or an orchard, you'll see a lot of it as wild pollinators actually doing the pollinating. And they often do it in weather conditions when the honeybees aren't active. So don't disrespect them, they're very important. British bee declines. Of our 260 or so species of bee, we've already lost 24. We've got 5 to 6 species that are critically endangered. Half of our bumblebees have declined substantially. Well, it's worth saying, a lot of bees are actually increasing because of climate change. But bees exhibit some of the worst declines of any British insects. And those declines are screaming information at you. So this map here belongs to the great yellow bumblebee. The hollow circles are where it used to be. The solid circles are where it is now. It's done a retreat to the fringes of Scotland and also the odd site in Ireland. It's done a retreat. And that is telling you something. That used to be in Warwickshire. If you go to the Herbert Art Gallery in Coventry, next to the main campus, there are specimens of great yellow bumblebee from Brandon, 1922. So it used to be in our part of the world. It even used to be in Kent, so it used to be all over the place. And it's declined, and I think the best way to describe that decline is it's not that its habitat is gone. The habitat is still there, but the habitat is very thinned out. Because the agricultural revolution has thinned out the habitat. So I always say, pretend your larder's empty, you need to get some provisions. But you have to drive to the north of Scotland for your milk, Ireland for your bread, probably the coast of East Anglia for your eggs. Your car's not very reliable, starts to break down, you get your bike out, you start doing it by bike, eventually you run out of calories, you lie on the roadside, you just give up. And that's why I like to think of what's happened to the great yellow bumblebee. Basically, the countryside has become too disjointed. The habitat it needs is too fragmented for it to survive. Some bees have declined more than others. People say, why have some bees declined more than others? I would say it's because they've got food intolerances and they need Waitroses rather than Spars, and they just can't cope. You know, there's not enough Waitroses for their gluten-free this and whatever-free that. So they just give up, and that's what's happened with this bee. And the only place where it can cope now is up there. This one did the same thing, but hid itself. It survived at Dungeness. It used to be all over the place, everywhere pretty much from the Scottish border southwards. This one here, and it ended up at Dungeness. And everyone thought, oh, Dungeness is really protected. It survived there. It popped off Dungeness, because actually it didn't need the shingle of Dungeness to survive. It actually needed Romney Marsh, which is the coastal grazing marsh, which went through agricultural intensification. So they're now reintroduced back from Sweden. This is a very sad story. This is Kuhlmann's bumblebee. The reason it's sad, it's described new to science from Suffolk. Hasn't been seen in Britain for about 60 years. Hardly even seen on mainland Europe now. It's a British bee. It's no longer British. Virtually extinct, possibly globally. So that's a really sad story. Okay. So the causes of pollinator declines, habitat loss and fragmentation, habitat deterioration, including this term succession, which is brought about by neglect. It's when you can imagine a lovely bit of flowery grass and it's been sheep or cattle grazed for centuries, then people take the grazing off, it turns to scrub and then woodland. That's what we call succession. And people don't use the land the way they used to before the agricultural revolution. So often lovely bits of grass have now turned to woodland, which isn't always very good for pollinators. Other things like pollution, and that includes particularly aerial pollution, and it's a bit of a problem in Britain, but in the low countries, nitrogen dioxide is having a profound effect on vegetation. And when the vegetation changes and you lose some of the plants, like things like birds for truffle or knapweeds, because your soil is becoming enriched, you lose a lot of the pollinators associated with those. You know, not only do they become less flowery, but you lose food plants for a lot of pollinators. So in fact, butterflies of the Netherlands and Belgium have suffered very badly because of aerial pollution. And also waterborne pollution can change vegetation communities. Agrochemicals, particularly neonics, very controversial, very polarising neonics, because the industry produces and thinks they're brilliant, and just about everyone else thinks they're not brilliant. Government wants to be with the industry. You know how it works. But yeah, neonics. But there's a lot of good information coming through regarding neonics, and I think most people now advocate precautionary principle, because we do think they're quite damaging. Disease, and I've got a picture here of a buff-tailed bumblebee. Well, it's not a bumblebee, it's Bombus terrestris. But it's interesting because it's not the... This is the species we get here. If you see the really huge queen bumblebees in spring, it's Bombus terrestris. But that's not the normal mainland form. That's a photo of one in Jersey. That's the continental form. And what was happening is they breed bumblebee nests up in colonies up in huge numbers in Europe or mainland Europe. And they import them around the world, and they were importing them into Britain for tomato greenhouse pollination. But not only were they bringing the wrong subspecies into Britain, so the one on the continent has a pure white tail, quite yellow bands, it looks quite different to the British one, which is a unique subspecies, but they were bringing in all the diseases, all the parasites. Hasn't affected Britain so much, but if you go to South America, major problems. The world's biggest bumblebee, for example, Dowbomb's bumblebee, is shown a massive crash, and that's because of Bombus terrestris in South America with all its diseases. The diseases spread to the native bumblebees, which aren't immune to them, and suddenly you get a massive decline of indigenous bumblebees. That's pretty serious. And there's also problems with honeybees. Honeybees have their own diseases, and those diseases can actually spread to other bees, like bumblebees. They're even finding the honeybee diseases in solitary bees now. That was reported this week. Then there's all the climatic factors. The weather is really weird at the moment. I mean, I've been a naturalist for 45 years. Maybe 40. No. I've been a naturalist for 45 years, and the weather in the last decade has been really weird. It's way off the Richter scale of anything I'm used to, particularly 2013, that really late spring. That was just bonkers. And then 2 years ago, I was jogging in shorts and T-shirts all through the winter. You know, in fact, some of the spring blossom started in January rather than May. We have hawthorn now in January, bonkers. And that has a massive impact. You know, you get a cold spring or a wet summer, has a massive impact on pollinators. And it's worth saying that all these things can work in tandem and reinforce each other. And that's why we think, well, we know, because there's great evidence from places like Germany and also from Rothamsted in Britain, that the sheer abundance of pollinators has declined substantially since I was a child. I used to come back from a family holiday, the car was splattered with insects. You know, and I remember that quite clearly. It would take hours to clean the car. You just don't get that anymore, and that's quite worrying. Okay. So, we've got an England National Pollinator Strategy, a strategy to protect pollinating insects which support food production, diversity of the environment, a call to arms, an emphasis on citizen science, which is one of the reasons we set up Blooms for Bees, because it's not about saving, it's partly about saving money, but it's more than that. I think citizen science is a good thing if it's designed properly, and there's a lot of energy and talent out there that can help professionals. So we now have national pollinator strategies for England, Wales, Scotland, and all Ireland. The all Ireland one is fantastic. It's a really good one. So we've now got stuff going on all over the place. Look at that. A green infrastructure action plan for pollinators for South East Wales. 270 pages long. Pretty cool. People doing stuff in Birmingham, turning that into that. It's great fun, exciting times, lots going on. Okay, so now I'm going to just focus on the main groups of pollinators, and then when I've done that, then I'm going to focus on the habitats. The habitats is fun, I'll come on to that in a bit. Bees, I don't have to go through all of this, but there's 260 on mainland Britain, there's about another 15 on the Channel Islands. They vary from tiny, there's a box of them at the back there, so you can see them. They vary from 3.5 millimetres long to 25 millimetres long, the great big queen bumblebees. 35 species are social. That's not just the bumblebees, but some of the things we think of as solitary, these are actually social. That means the females are divided into queens and workers. Doesn't mean, if you see a great big colony on your lawn, that doesn't mean social. that's just gregarious. To be social, the females have to be differentiated into mated queens that are fertilised and unmated workers who are the daughters that help the queen. They can still lay eggs, they can all lay eggs. An infertile egg in the bee, wasp and ant world turns into a drone. Because if any of you know your genetics, the drones, the males of bees, wasps and ants are haploid. It's unique within the animal kingdom. They are basically, if I pick up a drone bumblebee, I'm basically picking up a flying sperm in genetic terms. Okay, so we've got about, we've also got 74 of our bees. 74 are cuckoos of other bees. They take over the nests of other bees, lay their eggs in them, and use either the workers or the food for their own offspring. So in fact, some of the commonest species are cuckoos. So that leaves about 170 solitary species, about 100 of those nest in the ground in large soils, and another 70 less aerially, which is like in bee hotels or in a wall or on a dead tree, that sort of thing. Pollen is normally collected on the hind leg, but with some collected underneath the body. And most British bees visit a variety of flowers, but some are specialists. Some will only go for one particular flower, like yellow loosestrife or sainfoin. But most visit a variety of flowers. So that's bees in a nutshell. Oh, this is interesting. I'd like to show this picture because this explains something of the demands that some bees put on the countryside. This is called Perkins mining bee. It's quite a rare declined species. It's bivoltine. That means it has two generations a year. There's a spring generation and a summer generation that look a bit different. And for many years, they're regarded as different species. They're not. They're actually generations of the same thing. This is the one that comes out in spring, quite red-banded, quite a red, beautiful-looking thing. And it forages mostly on spring-blossoming shrubs like the blackthorn and the pussy willow. And it needs that sort of habitat in the spring. Then its offspring become a darker-looking summer generation, uses a totally different foraging habitat, lush meadows with angelica and thistles. And then as well as that, it nests along things like sandy footpaths or slopes that are very earthy slopes facing the sun. So not only has it got these requirements, it's also got the nesting requirements. So if you add that up, you start to see it's putting a lot of demand on the landscape. It can't cope with agricultural intensification. It can't cope with simplification of landscapes, which is what's happening. You can see at the distance there what's going on. But luckily it survives because it's got a nice coastal belt there. But yeah, if you were to put all those requirements into an Excel spreadsheet, and then you were to do that for every bee at a site, and there might be up to, I don't know, the best site's got 160 bee species, you start to see why you need very complicated landscapes for big bee assemblages. Now, you only have to lose that to lose all of that. You only have to lose that to lose all of that. This is why bees often decline very quickly. This is why bees are great barometers for health of the countryside and the health of the landscape. And then the parasites are even better barometers, things like oil beetles and the various other things that are cuckoos. They're even more sensitive. So you get all these barometers, canaries in the coal mine type scenario. When you start to lose these things, you know there are adverse changes in the countryside. Okay. If you think of a bumblebee colony, even more complicated, because a bumblebee colony can go on for months, particularly something like a red-tailed bumblebee. So the queens come out in spring, forage on things like pussy willow and blackthorn. They make their nest, then the workers come out and they forage in a whole range of flowers. They'll be moving all over the landscape through the season as different flowers wax and wane. Then eventually the drones come out. They like to sit around on knapweeds and thistles. So again, you can look at that landscape there and you can plot how that one nest that could be anywhere there, that nest, the workers could be travelling all over the landscape in order to bring about a life cycle. So when you start to lose those species, like the great yellow bumblebee, it's telling you something. It's telling you about how the landscape is changing. It's a great barometer of landscape health. Hoverflies, my first love. I went on Twitter the other day, I said, my first love was hoverflies. I started two-time room with bees. In fact, I've got a book at the back there. I co-authored the first book on the British hoverflies. But yeah, there's 280 British species. They vary from tiny to quite big, like the hornet hoverfly. Many look like wasps or bees. Some are even metallic green. The thing I love about hoverflies, they've got very varied biologies. So about half of them, about 150 of them have larvae that feed on aphids. They specialise on different aphids on different plants in different habitats. So that's an aphid feeding larva. About 40 of them are associated with dead wood or tree wounds. So you can go to something like, you can go to a site with veteran trees, really old trees, and you'll pick up very rare, like this. This is a really rare hollowfly of ancient beech woods. So you only find it Windsor Forest and the New Forest. And if you go to Europe, on mainland Europe, it's a thing of the very ancient beech woods of mainland Europe. So it's a, yeah, it's a very specialised species. Another 40 developing site plants. Another 40, many of the commonest ones, develop in shallow water. They have rat-tailed maggots, so they need shallow water. Others develop in dung, in fungi, in the nest of ants, social wasps and bumblebees. So very, very diverse biologies. A lot of them are very migratory and fly from the continent every year. But for the most part, they need open flowers. They're generous flower visitors. And they can be a lot more numerous at a site than a bee. So, you know, if you walk around here in the summer, you'll often see much more hoverflies than bees. So they're great, they're really great. I love them. I just really love them. Okay, other flies. Now, there's an awful lot. There are nearly 8,000 sorts of fly in Britain. Flies are my first love. I'm a dictrous. That's fine, primarily. And so I don't like to see these other flies disrespected by the people that love hoverflies. But it's worth saying that a lot of other flies pollinate, including blue bottles, which are breeding in carrion, things like the St Mark's fly, which you see in big numbers in spring and develops in the soil. That's a big pollinator of oilseed rape. Soldier flies, which develop in very clean water. So, yeah, perhaps as many as 1,500 flies in something like 15 families are also important pollinators, and they can be really abundant. They showed recently that dung flies, the yellow dung fly that you get on dog muck and cowpats, is one of the most important pollinators of certain rare orchids on the Hebrides. So there you go. So that's flies, butterflies and moths. So we've got about 2,500 species of moth in Britain, 72 butterflies. They're all flower visitors. I don't particularly rate them as great pollinators. They don't pick up a lot of pollen, but they're very beautiful, aren't they? And I think one of the most important things about butterflies, particularly butterflies, is they're good flagships. Certain really good habitats have certain rare butterflies, and when you start to lose those rare butterflies, it tells you the woodland is deteriorating or the grassland is deteriorating. So a good flagship for habitat quality. But they are just damn beautiful. They're just beautiful, aren't they? They have larvae called caterpillars. The caterpillars often need specific food plants in specific places. It's worth saying, as a generalisation, some of our rarest herbivorous insects use some of our commonest plants. Did you know that? And people say, why are they so rare? Because they often need those common plants growing in really specific conditions. Here's a good one. That's the common blue. It uses birds for trefoil. It's quite, it can cope with birds for trefoil in quite cool locations. It's quite a widespread butterfly. There's another butterfly called the dingy skipper, also uses birds for trefoil for its larval development. And it's very rare because it needs its birds for trefoil growing over bare ground, where when the sun shines, you get a little envelope of air that's about 30 degrees centigrade. And without that little pocket of air, the larvae, the caterpillars, can't develop. The common blue doesn't need that, but the dingy skipper does. And that's why the dingy skipper is so much rarer. And when you start to think of the landscape in those terms, it's great. It makes you think about, the whole thing about this talk is it makes you think about landscape in different ways. And we do take the landscape. We all take the landscape for granted, and we don't think hard enough about it. It's the best show on earth, guys. Better than any Hollywood film. It might repeat it. Okay, wasp and sawflies, they're small part players. Yeah, I'm not really going to know those. Beetles, even smaller part players. But some of them are quite furry, like this gorgeous rose chafer, it's quite furry underneath, so they can pick up a fair bit of pollen. Things like these, these soldier beetles, they can be the most abundant insects on certain flowers. So they're not very active, they're not moving around a lot, but they're picking up, you can see there's the odd bit of pollen on them, so they're probably moving pollen around to some extent. True bugs, yeah, they're very, very minor players, but some of them are very beautiful. I love that one. Goldfish. You can go to Jersey, that one's quite common on Jersey, on Channel Islands, yeah. There you go, that's your true bugs. So the key message is here. There are many types of pollinator. They visit many types of flower. Their larvae have life cycles of many sorts. You can look just in the grounds around here, you can kind of plug an insect larva into almost everything you see. Most critically, the larvae and the adults require very different needs, and you have to cater for both. So a lot of people think, oh, I'm going to put flowers everywhere for pollinators. What about what the larvae need? them larvae for much longer than their adults. Have you got the breeding sites for them? Because if you haven't, there's no point putting loads of flowers out if they haven't got any breeding habitat. Some adult pollinators, those have been bees, have very long foraging periods, so they often need big, diverse, varied sites to keep the life cycle going. And it's worth saying the larger and more complex, this is called a habitat mosaic, chalk downland, coastal grazing marsh, Borrow dike, so that's the dike that was formed, that's a flood defence, and the earth for the flood defence came from the borrow dike. Woodland, you know, there's loads of different habitats there. A complicated habitat mosaic is better for pollinators and, to be honest, for wildlife generally. There we go. And if you're particularly interested, and I've got copies of all of these at the back, I've got loads of stuff on the web, stuff I produce on Bugbife. It's written in very user-friendly terms for people who want to manage habitat for pollinators. I've got loads of stuff at the back there. Okay. And I've also done stuff for what I call promoting habitat mosaics, getting people, you'll notice it's the same picture here, trying to get people not to think just in terms of a single habitat, but think about the actual mix of habitats at a landscape scale, because that is the key to nature conservation. So I've got these sheets as well, they're all at the back there. So these are all sorts of things that are on the Buglife website. I worked for Buglife for 3.5 years, and this is part of my legacy there. Okay. So now what I'm going to do, how much time have we got left?
I
linger, when I'm with certain audiences, I linger on these, and we actually go through these in quite a lot of detail and actually have them, we talk our way through them. So I'm not going to do that here, but I enjoy this bit of the talk because this is about getting you to think about the countryside in slightly different ways, because the countryside is amazing. The environment is amazing. I was having a chat with Julius the other day. The environment, it's got to be the most complicated subject. It's just limitless. There's no end to it. There's just no end to it. You know, the species, and then exploring the species, and then exploring the physiology. I mean, it's just never ending. And I just wish people would think about it more. I mean, we think about the environment. There's a lot of people that they're not interested. A lot of people quite scared of the environment, to be honest. Anyway, starting with grassland. So the first thing to say is that existing species rich grassland, that's grassland that hasn't been ploughed for a few centuries, hasn't had loads of fertilizer put on it, is incredibly rare. So the first rule is you don't get rid of any existing old grassland, because there's been a 97% loss of it in the last 100 years, and it probably covers less than 1% of the UK land surface. Ironically, we still do lose it, even in Warwickshire. In the 27 years I've lived in Warwickshire, I've been quite shocked to see ongoing loss of ancient grasslands. So you want to preserve your old grasslands anyway, because it's like living archaeology, really. Okay, but then for the grassland that's left, so you've only got like a tiny bit of old grassland, but you want to create something that looks like old grassland because it's good for pollinators, it's flowery. So what do you do? Well, you can use wildflower seed mixes. But you should only try and use that where the natural flora is poor. You don't want to do any damage by putting the seed mix down. You've got to use a seed mix that's appropriate to the site. And you can get bespoke wildflower seed mixes. But even better, what you can do is and they do this quite a bit in Warwickshire, is you can take what's called green hay from a nature reserve with ancient grassland, and you can put it onto a new bit of grassland. The main thing though is you have to try and get the nutrient level of the soil down, because often old agricultural soils are over fertile, which means if you've got seed mix down, the seeds don't survive. The grass, the coarse grass, will get back in. So often farmers will do what's called nutrient stripping. Now they'll mow a bit of grass from an old bit of meadow for several years and take all the horizons off, and they draw out all the nutrition from the top levels of the soil. And when it's got down, the nutrient level's low enough, because fertility is the enemy. You don't want, for wildlife, you don't want highly fertile soil. Once you've got the fertility low enough, then you can put your green hay or your seed mix down. But if you do it whilst the soil is too fertile, it just doesn't sustain itself. So in terms of how you manage them, you can manage grassland by hay cutting or by grazing. They both got pros and cons. If you graze a lot in the summer, the animals eat all the flowers. So that's not always a good idea. But winter grazing is good. With hay cropping, if you cut your hay crop in late July or mid-July, often it's when it's still very flowery. So there are pros and cons of both things. The advice I often give to a farmer is if you've got quite a lot of hay meadow, don't cut all of it necessarily in 1 year, or leave nice broad margins. Don't cut, you know, from hedge to hedge. Try and leave a strip around the edge that's still flowering. That's the other thing. Things that people often think of as weeds are often very important for pollinators. So things like thistles, which are they're called injurious weeds. There's an Injurious Weeds Act, and it covers spear thistle and creeping thistle, which are two of our most important pollinator plants. Ragwort is covered by the Ragwort Act. Oh God, don't get me started. But you see people all over the country pulling out ragwort, saying it's poisoning our horses. It only poisons horses when it gets into a hay crop. When it becomes dried in a hay crop, then it's dangerous. The onus is really on the people that cut hay to keep ragwort out of their hay crop. But people are removing it from road verges, from nature reserves. And in certain weeks of the year, ragwort can be the single most important pollen and nectar source. Legumes are often very important, things like clovers versus trefoils. They can be very important for bumblebees. So a lot of people put down legume-rich grasses. Now you can see there's red clover there, birds for trefoil. But some people only put down legumes, and actually that's not good enough. You do have to put other sorts of flowers down. Umbellifers include things like carrots and hogweed, parsnips. Composites are things like your thistles, your daisy type things, all that sort of stuff. These are also very valuable, so you really want to mix the different flowers at a site. Other little features like old anthills, little wet depressions, ditches, pools within grass, and they're also very valuable. This gorgeous little hoverfly here develops in anthills. You know, you get those anthills, the larvae of this develop in anthills. And here we've got a common carder bee, it's one of our commonest bumblebees, and that's got quite a long tongue, that's on Burstfoot trefoil there. So that's a thing that needs legumes. So that's the key message of grasslands. If you want to see good grasslands around here, actually, the best grassland in Warwickshire is only a few miles from here, Draycott Meadow, which is a Wildlife Trust reserve. If you go there before they hay cut it, because if you go there sort of between April and June, it's a gorgeous site.
Is that near the reservoir?
Yeah. Yes, it is near the reservoir, but you have to go to the village to get to it. You can't get to it from it. It's a shame if they've got they should put a little fire in the reservoir. But it's wonderful. Hedges. People don't realise that Britain is internationally important for its hedges. A hedged landscape is a rare thing on a world basis. We get all of it in Britain. You've got the bocage, which is that Brittany, Normandy, the bocage, and then little bits in northwest Spain have got hedged landscape. It's a very ancient form of landscape. And certainly, if you were in America, you'd come in and think, wow, all those blossoming hedges. So, it's worth saying, we're very lucky actually. I don't know if you're aware, Warwickshire is on a very important boundary of two landscape types. If you go that way, towards Daventry and Banbury, you're into a planned countryside, which was open field systems until the Enclosure Acts about 200 years ago, and they put modern hedges, so that's a modern hedge landscape. If you go towards Birmingham or Stratford-upon-Avon from here, you're into what's called ancient countryside, the Arden, we call it the Arden, where the hedges are often 1,000 years old or more. So it makes Warwickshire a fascinating county, the hedges. And basically, generally speaking, the older the hedges, the more species it has. And if it has lots of blossoming shrubs, it's really good for pollinators. So I use this term blossom sequence. You want a good blossom sequence in a hedge, which can start, a hedge can include any of these species, and that gives you blossom from March right through to June. Oop. There you go, that's what I call a blossom sequence. So those are all the blossoming shrubs you can get in a single hedge. And that's what I'm always encouraging people. So that is absolutely brilliant for pollinators. Also very good for sloe gin. That's where you get your sloe gin from, blackthorn. Okay. In terms of how you manage a hedge, annual hedge trimming is really bad, and you see a lot of it where they cut the hedge every year, and you don't get very much blossom because they're constantly cutting it. The best thing to do is to cut it on a three-year cycle, you get a lot more blossom and a lot more fruit for the birds and such like. Okay. Also worth saying that the hedge, depending where the hedge is growing, it varies in its quality for pollinators. If it's facing sort of south and east, it gets more sunshine, and it's also protected from prevailing wind. So basically, the warmer and more sunny the blossom, the better for pollinators. Whereas if you've got a bit of blossom in a very breezy place, it's not so good for pollinators. In fact, it makes a huge difference. A little bit of breeze can reduce the insects on pollen on the blossom by about 90%. So when you're designing countryside, when you're managing countryside, you want to give an emphasis on concentrate the blossom where it's most sheltered, because you get a lot more insect activity. Hedge trees, so often within a hedge you get mature trees, so they can be blossoming species like cherry or sycamore. All of these are things that can occur within a hedge and produce blossom. If they're old trees, they often have rot, like rot holes or hollow trunks, which are used by pollinator larvae. Hedge banks, so on the ancient hedges of the Arden, the hedges are on banks. So if you go, if you follow some of those little country lanes between here and Birmingham, you'll see a lot of you've got sunken lanes with hedge banks on either side, which are they're medieval hedge banks, possibly even post Romano British, maybe more than 1,000 years old. But those hedge banks are really good because things, there's a hedge bank near where I live in Kenilworth, and you get things nesting in the slopes, and you get particular flowers along the slope, like bluebell. Sometimes you'll get a ditch alongside a hedge, that can be really good for larvae and various things, and ditches can be flowering. And then often you get things like fringing bramble or thistles. Yeah. Have I convinced you hedges are damn good? They're really good features, really good for pollinators. Fantastic. Woodland. Now this might surprise you. The worst types of woodland for pollinators and for wildlife generally is when it's just continuous tree cover. So that's the worst thing. That's quite a rare and modern phenomenon, having woodlands that are just continuous tree cover. Because up until the Second World War, pretty much all woodlands were managed by coppicing, particularly locally, which meant they were actually very open habitats because they were continually cutting them for either cutting the big trees for timbers or cutting the small growth for various purposes, fence making, charcoal making and such like. But basically, a woodland is better when it's got open spaces within it. And those open spaces can be clearings, which are sort of circular gaps, like that. That's a sort of clearing with perhaps have a pond in it, it's a circular gap. Or a ride. So a ride is much more of a linear track through a wood. If you go to any of the local woods, you'll see they've got big tracks. And they become very warm, very sheltered, very sunny. They often have very specific flowers growing along them. And that's much better for pollinators. What else can I say? Often trees contain blossoming shrubs, and often they have a lot of flowers, like bluebell, but the flowers tend to come out very early before the canopy appears. You can get lots of dead wood in a wood, lots of pollinator larvae developing the dead wood, believe it or not. So dead wood creates pollinators. What else can I say? Yeah, so the way you manage a woodland can affect the pollinators you get there. So yeah, if you coppice it, have I got any coppicing? That's a bit of coppicing. That's a coppice stool, that's hazel. So what they would have done historically, they would have cut that every sort of 7 or 8 years and cut that back and use these for making charcoal, for making fences, even for making walls of old-fashioned houses. But that stopped about 50 years ago, but you still see it. If you go into the woods, you can see the old coppice stools. Scalloped rides, so you get these linear gaps going through a wood, these rides. If you manage them by scalloping them, so they're not parallel sided, if you create like embayments, you get a lot more insect activity because you get a lot of shelter. If you've got like a breeze going through the wood, if you've got lots of scalloping, you get these little hot spots, little warm areas. I often think one of the best things we could do as ecologists is to have what they call infrared glasses that can see heat sensor glasses, because we've studied so much in the countryside, the one thing we've never studied properly is the microclimates and the heat regimes of the countryside. But you can sense it, because I walk around the site with my arms exposed, and I can actually feel when it's going warm and cold. And when my arms start to get warm, I see lots more pollinators. And when it's a bit breezy and my arms are cold, the pollinators aren't there. So it's called microclimate. So there you go, so that's woodland. Road verges, I've done a lot with road verges. Last year, my biggest contract was working for Highways England, and I had to survey 70 sites, 70 road verges in the West Midlands. Nearly every motorway system, every time I drive around the motorway system, I'm like, oh, I've done that bit. But that's what I did, because Highways England are very concerned about, well, they've got a lot of money for boosting wildlife and pollinators. So road verges are often natural wildlife corridors, because you think of somewhere like Warwickshire, where intensively farmed, often the road verges have got